as long as it's done, I think, respectfully, and also it's based on facts.
How about that?
Well, yeah, but in today's day and age, your facts are, you know, I mean, just, you know, everyone's facts are their own kind of imagination.
Sure.
I love honesty in sales. I think honesty, shocking honesty, is so attractive to people because nobody does it.
True.
And Claude, I'll piggyback onto that. I think in just real life, how much honesty do we get? And when we get it, don't we appreciate it?
Yeah.
Part of a lot of guts is not sales, it's just real, truthful human interaction.
Well, now you have people being authentic because authentic is working, right? Mm-hmm. So they're being like a fake authentic.
Authentic. That's a
fake authentic.
A contrarian term. Christian, ask me. Let's do a quick role play. Just have some fun here. Claude, what? Say it real nasty too. Claude, why should I work with you? Why should I do business?
Claude, why would I ever want to work with you?
Maybe you shouldn't.
Yeah.
I was thinking the same thing. I really was. Why are we even talking today? What's the point of this conversation? What are we both
looking for? I wanted to ask you some questions.
Oh, well, that's fine. So when you say, why should you work with me? And I say, you shouldn't. You should only work with me if you want somebody who answers his phone, who's on time for meetings, who wants every session to be productive and entertaining and enjoyable, and so that you get unbelievable value for your money. So maybe I'm not the right guy for you.
No, I mean, if you can do that, I think we should continue to talk.
And as my mentor would say, this is how you turn chicken shit into chicken salad.
Exactly. It's interesting, gentlemen, how some people can't handle the truth. It reminds me of that old film with Jack Nicholson. What's the movie called? You Can't Handle the Truth, he says.
You good man.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Right?
It's, you know, we can turn negative situations, whereas other people are defensive or threatened by it. You know, when you say something to somebody like that, you know, why should I work with you? Well, and then they give their whole resume and everything like that. I use a lot of psychological triggers. I say the unexpected, maybe you shouldn't. And I put a little theater into it, but take what I call a dramatic or pregnant pause. Maybe you shouldn't. That really gets your attention and throws you what I call off balance. You're going to yourself, oh shit, how do I answer that? I didn't expect that. But do I have your attention now? And how important is intention? Getting someone's attention and input, getting them to contribute to the conversation rather than just reading a script that, you know. So to me, these are moves you can do. I get people go, well, I spoke to all your competitors. I spoke to A, B, C, D, and E. And you know, what do you have to offer? You know, and I say, those are really good people.
Yeah.
They've been in business a long time. You're not going to hear me disparage them or anything. Maybe you should work. Maybe you should work with them. When you spoke to A, B, C, D, and E, you must have made a commitment to one of them or signed a contract, didn't you? Yeah, boom. And now, what does that force him to do?
Yeah.
Explain himself
and defend his decision not to make a commitment. So what would you like for me in order for us to make a commitment today? See, there's so much fun psychology in redirection and all this stuff. I took a long run with my son today, and we were talking about sales, and I spoke a lot about stroking and nurturing people. Nurture them, you know, and get them emotionally involved. And it's so much easier to sell people that way.
Claude, I just want to add on to this, and I hope it relates to the conversation. One of the things that I do is when I ask a prospect, even though I'm not in real estate, I learn a lot from guts. When I ask someone a question, I will just stay quiet.
It's hard.
What's that?
But I agree.
What kind of question?
You put me on the spot on it, but that's something I've learned. throughout my journey, not only with you, but a few other people, because a lot of people, you ask them a question and you want to jump in, and but you want to give that person time, because it shows that you're waiting for them and you're giving space for them to answer that question.
Feels like an eternity though, when you're waiting for it's when you're exactly. hearing the crickets and everything. So you might want to focus on asking open-ended questions or multiple choice questions. I use that sometimes when I have reluctant people.
Yeah.
Dr. Vibe, wait, let me ask you something. If I wanted to know about your financial status right now, would you say it's good, it's bad, it's excellent, you're working on it? Where would you classify yourself, sir?
It's good. Now, a lot of people, again, they're going to take time to answer that. Give them the time to answer that.
Well, it's much easier than saying, what's your credit rating?
What you got in the bank?
Because that's the drawbridge comes up when you ask those direct pointed, hey, it's really none of your business. I don't know you that well. What, you know, it's a, you know, my 11th commandment. Who knows my 11th commandment? It's one of my funny commandments. Moses dropped one on the way down.
You'll go to heaven even if you abuse a salesperson?
Yeah, you're right there. You can still get into heaven and treat a salesman like shit.
Yeah. And another thing that I've learned a lot from Claude, tone of voice. Huge. Because I know the way Claude speaks with us, like on here on a Monday, is different probably than the way he speaks to a client one-on-one.
Oh yeah. Sometimes I'm a loud guy. But, you know, okay. Because I'm enthusiastic. I get loud sometimes. I get passionate about what I do. But there's you know, part of persuasion and influence and getting someone over to your side of thinking, or to get them to want to do business with you or like and trust you, it's a little bit about theater.
Yes. Too.
The enunciation, the pentameter, do you lean forward? Do you speak loud? Or do you speak softly? Yeah. You know, a lot of that combined with it is also very, very important. Christian, you had a question, and I know you posted a question when you scheduled with me, and I don't want to ignore your question, because this topic, we could go for hours on this stuff.
Oh, this is a good topic. And I actually did have a comment on what we were just talking about telling the truth. The amazing thing is, if you tell the truth directly like that, it's actually a pattern interrupt, because people are not expecting you to tell the truth. They want you to they're expecting the salesperson is going to sugarcoat everything and tell them what they want to hear.
In the military, I call it shock and awe. What happens when you, because most people are very in sales and stuff, they say the things they think the prospect wants to hear. I tell them the things I think they need to hear. And that gives you so much. Number one persuasion trigger, psychological trigger, is likability. Do they like you? Do they feel good about you? Or are they cautious? Oh, this is a salesperson. This person wants to put their hand on my wallet. You know, what is it that you can do to get people to like you? What are some of the movements you can do to get that, you know, it's tell them the truth. How about that, right? The truth. Sir, I get people, well, Christian, if I work with you, am I going to make $25,000 in December?
I don't know, maybe, Claude.
Okay, wait.
Is that what you're looking to do?
Yeah, what if you know I won't? It's unreasonable. I've never made more than $2,500 in a month in my lifetime. And in the same business now, I found your webpage, I call you up, and I want to make $25,000 in a month. And that's not really realistic. What can you do to gain my trust, likability, and respect, and still tell me the truth?
You first of all, stroke, right? Great. I admire the fact that you have so much motivation, Claude, that you've reached out to me and you want advice to make $25,000 a year. I have to admire a man with that type of persistence.
Nurture. That was a great stroke. Stroke lead to nurture. Claude, what would you do with that money? Would you take your wife on a trip?
Give him a vision.
Go into nurturing and then go into maybe a commitment. a micro commitment, and then go into a shocking thing. Claude, can I tell you the truth, or do you want me to just make you feel good today? Go ahead. I'm sorry to interrupt, but those, I want to see you put, there's step-by-step here.
This is good.
Claude, the fact that you work so hard, I'm sure you're working for your family, your wife, your kids, that making that $25,000, can you just imagine what you would do with that money?
That would be a dream come true. We got another baby on the way. We're living with our parents. We want our own place. We want to, I'm sick of, you know, these installment payments I'm making at 21%. We can't catch up. I need to make more money so I can get out of debt and I can treat my family the way they deserve to be treated, you know?
Claude, I have to tell you, I'm really moved by that story. The fact that you're so motivated to get out of debt,
so good,
to get a new house for your family, to provide for your newborn baby. I mean, I have to hand it to you, Claude. You know, if we could get you on track to achieve those goals, would you be willing to sign up to work with me today?
Off the role, please. Do that again and use the word imagine.
Claude, imagine we could meet all of those goals for you. If I could do that for you today and we work together for, say, 3 to 6 months, are you willing to sign up and work with me for that period of time to be able to meet those goals?
Okay, you're asking me for a kiss, but you haven't bought me a drink yet. I want you to take it out and put it into a third person. Claude, imagine for a moment you found somebody who could help you and your family, yada, 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 A, B, C, D, E.
Yeah.
What would you say to that person? Use a straw man argument rather than a sell, where you're going into that salesman mode right away. And now he's immediately, this is what he really wants. This is why he was nice to me. Use a little bit of a straw man, a third party argument, and slowly, this is the seduction part. You're slowly getting in where make me want to buy from you. It's kind of a little, it's called conversational hypnosis, what we're doing here right now. Okay, so try the third party straw man. Same thing you did, but instead of saying you, if you found a person or company or a program that could get you to those goals, that isn't something you take an action on right away and use a little redirection. Sorry, go ahead. A little micro corrections here.
Claude, all those goals are very admirable. If there were somebody that could help you out to achieve those goals in the time period that's to your satisfaction, that's not anything you'd want to do today, is it?
I would, if I could really find somebody, maybe you, somebody like that, I'd jump on it. I really would, if I could afford it. Your program, you have, is that what kind of what your program would help me to do if I was interested in it?
Yeah, I mean, Claude, that's definitely what we do. I mean, have you talked to anyone else about this? Because you should probably look around a little more before you make a decision.
Ooh, what, off the role play, what did he do that was so brilliant just now? That was brilliant, Christian. Did you guys hear it? It was very stealth. Speaking of stealth, Steve Driscoll is in the building. Good to see you, Steve. What did Christian just do? That was brilliant. You guys, it was so hidden, so stealthy, you might not have even heard it.
I missed it.
One of the things I did like, say, hey, you know, check other people out. Like, he gave him the opportunity to look at other people. So he wasn't saying me, me, me. Hey, check the field out. So he gave him opportunity to check out other people. I thought that was, and you don't hear that too much.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was very subtle. How did you exactly say it, Christian? Do you remember?
It was good.
Claude, have you talked to anyone about this? You may want to do a little bit of research first.
Love it.
What is he? Do you ever hear salespeople push? Why is he pushing me away? Very comfortably, very warmly. He's pushing me away almost. What's the natural reaction that he knows I'm going to do, but he has the guts to push me away? Did you notice that?
Yeah.
What's he hoping? What does he think the reaction might be?
either one of two things. Well, he says, no, I want you. Or because he gave that opportunity, that person's going to search on and he's going to come back to him. And I think most prospects would say, what's this guy doing? Why isn't being aggressive? He's actually giving me the opportunity to look at other people. That's weird. That's different. He must be really confident that, say, look at other people out there. That's a sign of confidence.
Confidence is powerful. It's very powerful. And what he might get from that prospect is the reason he didn't go with those other people. Maybe yes. He'll find out, was it a money issue? Was it he didn't get to talk to somebody he liked or trusted? Was he speaking to a phone room? Now he's forcing the prospect to justify his previous decisions. And he brings, instead of he's pushing him a little bit back, but he's coming in stronger and stronger. Also, he's getting me involved in the conversation too. How important is it to get that prospect to converse with you? How important is that to get to likability and trust? Let's go do that one more time. It's too good to pass. We got to role play that out. Go ahead one more time, Christian.
Claude, have you checked anyone else out and did some research before you decide what you want to do?
I have. I've spoken to a few people, but to be perfectly honest, I wasn't comfortable with them, you know, for the money they were charging.
Oh, not comfortable with the money. I mean, what was more of the turnoff? I mean, was when you say you weren't comfortable, what do you mean by that?
Well, I wasn't speaking to the head honcho. I was speaking to some phone room in India or something. Nice fella, but I felt like I was talking to a salesman rather than someone who was really, someone who was trying to sell me rather than give me what I really need. I got to be honest with you. I called you and you answered your own phone and we set up an appointment and that's fantastic. That you can do that. That's fantastic, Christian. I really like, that's very impressive to me.
Claude, I appreciate that. I mean, I strive not to run my business like a sales room where we outsource our help. Everyone that I help with, I personally work with them and I provide one-on-one service. So, you know, Claude, it sounds like
close me.
You might be interested in...
Close me right now. You okay, got me. Yeah. You bought me two drinks. I'm happy.
Claude, what I can propose to you today, if you want to work with somebody one-on-one, you don't want that outsourced salesperson, we could sign up today for 6 months. You and I work one-on-one personally. You tell me what your goals are financially, personally, and we meet those goals within a 6 month period. If we could do that, is this something you want to sign up for today?
You know, I feel pretty good about this. I think we should go forward. I feel really good about this.
Oh,
excellent. Cool. Visa and MasterCard.
Boom. You just closed me. Yeah. You've got to work for the magic moment. There is a magic moment in sales and most people either don't see it, don't create it, or just jump over it and ignore it. There's a magic moment in sales. When they bring up a stall or an objection, that's your opportunity to close. When they return the compliment to you, I like that you answer your phone, you're taking time to talk, speak with me. You're giving me good old-fashioned accountability and customer service. I really like that. You know, boom, there's your moment to close. Now you hopefully have qualified them. You don't have a money issue, a decision-making issue, a timeliness issue, something like that. But when you get that magic moment, go for it. But you know, I think most salespeople overlook the chance to get a contract, a commitment, a check, a MasterCard all the time. That's where that listening thing.
This crap about going back to the well and asking the person 5, 6, 7 times if they're ready, they're ready, they're ready. You know, can you hear me?
You're a little muffled. You're muffled for some reason.
Yeah, I don't know why. I got to work on a sound system. If the nonsense of going back and asking people over and over and over again if they're ready, if it's 5 or 6 closes, is all bullshit. You know, you
got what do you think's going through their mind when you do that old fashioned sales thing? But you know, you keep asking for the order. What do you think goes through their head?
First off, you're not confident. Number one, all right. Number two, you're not. You're just like you sound like the same old guy that's been out there calling them before, I would imagine. So you want to. You're not dealing with a professional. You're dealing with a guy that's just slamming the ball. Just slamming through the.
I would add to that, if I'm in a situation, I feel like I'm not being listened to. And it's a form of disrespect. So you're beginning to turn me off and saying, okay, whatever. You're becoming repelling, not accepting.
Number one psychological trigger for making money today, getting commitments, contracts today, is likability.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get a total stranger to like us in the first phone call, the first meeting? How do we do that? Some people call it rapport, but I don't think they really understand what rapport means. How do we get somebody enthusiastic about our product or service without being condescending, without being, gee, that's wonderful. Everything you say is rainbows and unicorns. No. You know, how do you get a total stranger to fall in love with you?
Using guts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm amazed about how much I don't know. I read so much different aspects of psychological persuasion all the time. And I listen for it. I read it. I look for it. And I try to apply that good old fashioned thing called common sense a lot of times. I'm the easiest, I say this all the time. I am probably, it should say schmuck on my forehead. I am so easy, I am so easy to sell. But nobody knows how to sell me.
Tell me.
It's so funny. I'll go in the, you know, guys know my airport story. I'm in Denver airport. We got an hour and a half before the flight. So I tend to take walks. I like to get in my mileage. There's a really cute young woman at a kiosk selling overpriced t-shirts, $35 a t-shirt. I bought two of them. Why? I'm just taking a walk and I come back to my wife. Honey, I just spent $80 with taxes and everything. Here's a t-shirt.
I can see Claudia rolling her eyes.
Yeah. What do you think this young woman did to make me spend that kind of money? I had no intention of buying anything, much less an overpriced t-shirt. It says, welcome. It says Colorado hippie on it or something. Really happened.
I would guess that the likability factor was there. You just like the way, like, and to me, a lot of times people buy you before your product or service that you're offering.
I wanted to make her smile. She was so cute. She was paying attention to an old dude. She was working. She was just cute. She was reminded me of my daughter. She was just cute. She was working hard. And I just wanted to make her smile. She had me at, what's that? What was the movie you said before? This is Jerry Maguire. She had me at hello because she was just very nice to me.
Yeah.
Those are the people you want to hire.
Yeah.
Those are the people you want to hire.
Absolutely.
And she engaged me. How are you today, sir? You got to, look, I see it. Like your sneakers or something she did to engage me. And I don't think most people will initiate a friendly conversation. Okay. I practice this all the time. This is one of my things I give to my students. Hey, talk to the Walmart greeter, talk to the barista, talk to the lady in front of you who has a shopping cart full of Captain Crunch.
Absolutely.
You know, gee, do you like that cereal? You bought a lot of Captain Crunch. How many kids? Can you initiate a conversation and make someone smile or laugh or like you?
Yeah. Claude, I will add onto that. And you've one of the people that taught me this. I have a mindset, the more you know, the more you need to know. And always be curious, ABC, always be curious.
Yeah.
Because for me, a lot of my ideas come from areas that I have no relationship with. But I say, how did they do this? How can I adapt it with what I do? Always be curious.
Oh, yeah. You know what the three most powerful words in sales are? Ask me a question, Christian.
Claude, how do I make $25,000 extra a year?
I don't know. I don't know.
There you go.
I don't know. It's a great question. It's an interesting question because that's a lot of, that's a dream for you. Now, you must have brought that up for a reason. Help me out.
Bam.
Opens up a whole
kind there of you thing. Go. Bam.
And you get to show them what kind of experience you have after you get, after you think through it all and you show that you're caring about it. And you said that.
Yeah.
Oh, what a great question that is.
Yeah.
Patting them on the back.
So. Personal. You're being personal with them.
What happened? Do salespeople ever say, I don't know?
Nope.
I have all the answers to all your questions. Oh, yeah, let me tell you all about the history of the shoelace. You know,
true. And that goes back to what we were saying in the beginning about telling the truth.
There you go.
By making like you know everything, you're obviously not telling the truth.
You talk about politicians.
There you go.
What happens on Meet the Press when they ask them a direct question? And that's why I think there's a lot of animosity towards politicians. You go to a politician, do you like chocolate or vanilla ice cream?
They can't answer that.
You know, they can't say chocolate or vanilla. They got to talk about something
they
else.
They can't say yes or no.
And I love politicians, even if I disagree with them. But if they give me an honest, straightforward answer, I think that to me, that's very attractive. Very, you know, I like that.
I'm still waiting to see one.
Yeah. There's a few of them out there, and they do get into trouble when they answer questions honestly.
Yeah.
You know, people don't want to hear what the person's truth is. They want to hear that fits their political agenda, what suits, you know, what makes them feel well.
When you're cold calling and you're making phone calls, sometimes these calls can dive over to the left side and you start talking about the economy and how they're not able to make the payments on their insurance and this and that. And, you know, and it's a big thing today. It's a very big thing today. You want to try not to get political when you're on the phone talking with somebody, but you want to, if you can share a common ground with them, that's very, very important in building rapport. If you can share a common ground and create one, you got it made.
Yeah.
It's that, but you've got, here's the problem. And I'm guilty of this in the early days. I worked so much on rapport and bonding. Let's talk about sports, the weather, the politics, all the stuff. But the whole point of the conversation is, of course, to have somebody buy your stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, and you get caught up in this very long, friendly adult-to-adult conversation, but you never get to the real issue, the emotional catalyst. Sir, I don't understand, and you got to use, I use a lot of redirection to get, sir, I don't understand what you, I want to play the doctor in the room is my analogy. You guys always hear me say that. Sir, Christian, why are we meeting today? What would you like from me? You must have something on your mind. Maybe I can help you or offer you a few solutions.
Actually, I had that situation come up last week and it was funny. I had the opportunity, for those who don't know, I work in the media sense, and you're saying, what is this guy doing? And I really say, guts works. So I had the opportunity to meet a senior vice president of one of the biggest media entities in Canada last week or 2 weeks ago.
Right.
And originally was supposed to be a half an hour meeting, 10 minutes before it became a 15 minute meeting. So I had my three asks that I wanted to get from her.
You asked, good for you.
So ahead of time, I said, because I don't want to leave any meeting with my pockets empty. The least I want is, can I follow up with you in a few months? Because I put energy there and I want to make sure I leave with something. Even if they say no for right now, I want to get that commitment from them that I can follow up with them in a few months. So when I call them back, I'm not bugging them. I'm telling them, you gave me permission to give you a call back. So it's not me bugging them. So I went into this meeting with this lady. And the first question I asked her was, because I want to get a program on her platform. I asked her, what are your organization's goals for the next 12 to 18 months? And she goes, that's a hard question to ask. I don't know how to answer it. And she says, well, so then I got to the question, what is the process of getting content on her platform? And she said, She outlined it and she goes, well, you've got to have an idea. I had an idea. And then she asked me, why do you have that idea? So I had to make sure I had a story. And then after that story, she said, you know what? I can relate to that so much. Here is the con. I'm going to personally introduce you to the people you need to speak to, and I will introduce you personally to them.
Oh, wow. Keep asking.
Keep asking.
Can't hurt to ask.
Yeah. And she was kept. And I want a lot of people get intimidated by these things, but it's a chance for you to show yourself, be on the offensive, not on the defensive. And Claude has always been great at that. That mindset, it's so much a mindset. You're not going there to be on the defensive. You're the person who has stuff to offer. You want people to ask you questions.
What's the worst somebody can say? No.
No.
That's not a judgment on who you are as a human being, as a person. It just means that you didn't work enough, or there was no connective tissue there. There was no way to
connect. Or it gives you another way to turn around and reposition yourself.
Exactly. Yeah. Why are you saying no? Mm. Is it too much money? Is it not the right time?
It's always the money.
It's always
a little stroke 90, in there before you know it, and you're back in the game again.
Yeah, 95%, at least in my business, it's a money issue. Because I work so much on the pain or the need or greed or motivation. So what is it you're looking for? What is the, if you had a, one of the things, I haven't done this in a long time. If you had a magic lamp and you could make a wish, what would that wish be? What is it you're looking for? What is it you want? You've got to get them emotionally involved in talking. Sir, you have a house for sale. What's the issue? Why didn't you give it to a realtor? Or how come it hasn't sold in this really a dynamic market right now? What do you think's the problem? Why are you even selling this home? You're living in it. You need a place to live. Maybe you should stay there for a while, right? Right. And then they justify their decisions. And they tell you why they can't use a realtor because they can't afford the commission, or for some other reason, or it's a property that needs $100,000 worth of. You get that information from them by always going in the opposite direction that they're expecting. And that's hard to do on a spontaneous conversation.
True.
It takes a little time and practice, but when you push them away. See, I don't understand. Can you help me? I'm not sure if I understand. Why are you selling your home?
Well, I got relocated, Claude.
But not what, 2022, 23? I mean, you must have a lot of time.
Oh, right? I got to be out of here in January.
Oh my gosh. A friend of mine that happened to, and he was stuck with two mortgages, same situation. Oh my, and it cost him his marriage. It cost him his financial credit line. He went bank. It was horrible. He even lost the job because he was so, I shouldn't have told you that story. I'm sorry.
Well, I wish you didn't tell me this story. I don't want to be in that position.
Yeah. What did I just, so did people, that's so Colk. Many, go ahead, Steve.
No, so many people come out of the box and they're asked, so many people come out of the box and they're asking on the phone within the first 15 seconds, can you tell me why you're selling your house? Man, I'm not telling you jack shit. I'm not telling you why. how business is it yours? But if you turn around and say, wow, sir, this I got from Claude. Sir, how long have you been living there? Oh, I've been living there 10 years. Wow, you must have good roots in the neighborhood and all that. I mean, certainly, you really don't want to sell this house. Why would you want to move? Boom, and then you you put them on a whole different keel. Before I forget, I want to say something before I forget, and it's important. When I was out in Vegas, I don't know, it was a while back. I was at a business transformation meeting. Who's there? But Steve Wynn. All right. At the time, he was losing his eyesight. He might be blind by now. I don't know, but he was putting up these giant hotels, one in Singapore, and all this, and he was walking around telling us all about it. But he says, what do you attribute your success to? So he says, he named a few people, but he says, what I can do, he says, I love walking around to my employees and my he calls them tenants, his people that are in his hotels and all that, his customers, and stroking their ego. And if you can do something to stroke their ego and make them feel good about themselves,
yes,
he says, you own them. He says, they're yours.
So important.
Claude does that. You know, stroking the ego and working it into the conversation. But this guy does it through and through with everything that he does in this hotel. And he loves to be one-on-one. You get in a hotel with him at the Mirage,
the Luxor. Luxor, the pyramid.
Yeah, and he gets on the elevator with you, and he's talking to you, just like that. You know, guy, really, really nice guy.
Steve, that's a great point you brought up. Have we lost the ability to converse one on one with people, and we're all dependent on all this digital stuff?
Younger people are having a real hard time with it. It's texting. Look how many companies now you want to do business with. And they start off and they've got 24-hour service, and you know, you pick up the phone and call them. 6 months later, after the company is established or whatever it is, now it's all email or texting. Yeah. You can spend 3 hours going back and forth with somebody that you can settle in 5 minutes on a telephone.
Yeah.
But they don't care about that.
Why? That's the thing I'm curious about. Why have we lost this ability to... You know, the old-fashioned door-to-door vacuum cleaner salesman and stuff like that. I'm sure there's somebody doing it still, but not many. Okay, you have a vacuum cleaner store now, an Oryx store or something like that. Why have we, is it all the digital components, all the electronics, or why have we lost culturally in one-on-one? Why have we lost that?
I think there's the illusion that we can get things done faster by texting or emailing and getting an instantaneous answer. But the reality is you need to send out a multitude of text and email for something you could do very easily in a conversation.
I think I agree with that. I'm going to add on, I think more and more people don't value relationships. Mm. I don't think we really value relationships as we once did. I remember one of the first things Claude said to me, and I use it with people today still, give good phone.
Yeah.
Like if it's something, if it's facts, a text is good. But if it involves any sort of emotion, you either call that person or you do a face-to-face on a screen with them. Like I had this situation up to last night. I had to step down from an organization, and I told the head of the organization, I said, you know what? Things aren't really working out. And the first thing she says, I'm so glad we did this over a phone. She said, well, I would never do something that just saying I'm leaving via text. It's not my style. But I don't think we value relationships like we used to. Not saying everybody, but a lot of young people, it's almost like everything's disposable. It's like a recycle bin. We're treating too many things like the recycle bin.
When you watch television and you have a couple that's going out and everything's great, and they break up over a text. They don't even want to have a communication.
Right.
There was a thing at Yankee Stadium, whatever it is, 2 years ago. They're all open, everything's good. The guy proposes to his wife over a text at the stadium, and she was out getting a hot dog. Now, they knew this was set up, because when they came back, it was like the family was all there, and they had it. But this is the thing of all that. Are you kidding me? Are you going to use text? No.
I'm a little bit old school, but I think another thing, my dad raised me, he said, look, I don't care what you become in life, as long as you treat people with manners and respect.
Good dad.
Right?
Check means everything.
Yep. Those sort of things. There are many things that are old school that are still and will always and ever feel good. And when you do them today, you'll stick out in a good way.
And how attractive is that to people socially or business-wise, when you're doing some of these really good character traits and things like that. One of my lines, I love using this line. I said, sir, if you and I do business today, I want you to know you get my personal phone number. Only my family and kids have that number and my trusted clients. You become part of my extended family. That's how I feel about coaching, mentoring, consulting with people.
You're valuing people. They feel valued.
You know,
because so many people, so like Steve was saying, when a client starts opening up, how many people get a chance to tell you their story and you listen to them and you respect them? when you do that, you've already half won over the clients.
My doctor gave me his personal cell phone number. Wow. Because I said, you know what, when once I get the lab back, it was just the blood work. So I said, I'm gonna have one or two questions. He says, yeah, let me give you my number. I said, I promise I won't abuse it. I know you're entitled to your privacy and everything. I won't call you 10 times. He says, I know that about you, Claude. Here's my number. Do I love this man? Oh my God. You know, yeah. What doctors or give you their personal cell phone number, you know?
Well, it's here's another funny story. Yeah, well, it's funny. There's a restaurant that we order from at least once or twice a month. We've been doing it for years and years and years. And about 2-3 years ago, I went in there and it's a husband and wife that own it. And they said, you know what, can we get your phone number? And I said, like, why do you want my phone number? He says, look, if we ever have any challenges, we want to reach out to you for help. Wow. Wow, I was humbled. I was really, really humbled. And just an incredible couple that have been around the world. They know 6 different languages, but to just have those sort of things, those things don't happen a lot anymore.
Yeah.
And salesmen have the opportunity to develop it. Claude has developed that. You just got to be willing to do the work.
Yeah.
I'm not perfect.
It's not even work. It's a labor of love.
It's a way of living. It's not even a labor. It's just a way of living.
What we're doing right now, I love doing this.
Yeah.
I love doing this. I learn, you learn. We have an exchange of ideas. We do have a goal to set to get better in sales, persuasion, marketing, things like that. There is a context to it and everything. But can you imagine doing something you love and being rewarded for it? And continue to have a lifestyle that you, I love working from home way before it became fashionable. I love the cleaner bathrooms, better coffee. I love working from home. You know, I've done the corporate commuter thing and I was very unhappy with it. It wasn't me. You know, can you imagine doing something you love? Go ahead, Steve. I'm sorry.
You ought to try doing it now from the real. It's 3 hours in rush hour to get across New York City to get to Jersey. 3 hours.
Holy smokes. You've never seen
so many cars. It takes me 4 hours to get off the ground.
It's anyway. What's the value of your life? You're ever going to get that time back? You know that you spent all that running around and doing things that were unproductive.
Mm.
Okay. I mean, everything we talk about here, it sounds wonderful, but it has to be practical too. You got to put mac and cheese on the table.
Absolutely.
Grills and things like that.
Well, more and more these days, I was working with a lady recently, I was helping her amplify her business. And I said to her, look, if I'm helping you, either going to help you make money, save money, or get you back your time. And she has 2 young kids. You know, which one was most important to her?
Time
was the most important thing for her.
I go to people something on the same genre as you just said. I said, you know what? I'm going to be part of the solution or part of the problem.
I love that. I got to use that. I like that one. I like
that. Again, isn't that the truth?
Yes, exactly. Yes. And usually I get a laugh out of it. And you know, humor is a very strong psychological trigger for persuasion.
Write it down. I got to tell you.
Yeah, because especially during these times, people need to laugh. And if you can bring some laughter in their life, they're going to stick on to you because they need that light. Yeah. They need that light.
Yeah. We need to laugh more. We're not laughing enough in society. I don't think everything's a little too serious.
Are we allowed to laugh? I forgot. I didn't see that on the news last night. We're allowed to laugh anymore. Tell people laugh is better than crying.
Oh yeah, laughter is wonderful. I go running every day. I took a run with my son who was visiting us here in North Carolina. And you know, after you do a run, a lot of times you get this endorphin effect. It's a chemical thing in your body that just makes you, it's a runner's high, they call it. And if you could get that just in talking to people and running your business,
I do
get that hey, I'm happy, you know, effect. That's a pretty good way to live.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, I have to go. This was a half hour meeting that you guys should have a lot longer. You know.
This is great. Claude, one comment I want to make is you've done this before, but I don't remember you calling it out in our role play, the third party story before selling yourself. That was great. I picked that up from this session. I don't remember hearing that before.
It's the
3.0.
3.0. We're going well. I still have to come out with 2.0, but this is a new design I just had someone do for me, so I threw it up there. I really like purple. The thing about it is, when we say, I think Dr. Vibe said it before, when we say me, it looks self-serving.
Yeah.
When we say, if you found a solution, you found a person who you trusted and you felt good about that, what they were offering, buying, selling, invest, whatever. And you felt good. Well, you wouldn't take an action right away, would you? See, I'll use the straw man argument. Okay. And I got this from law school. A lot of things by other people, you listen and you learn, you get great ideas from other people sometimes. And you do that straw man argument. And then with a little positive or negative redirection, you want a positive answer, go negative. If you found the solution, Christian, you wouldn't, that's not something you could take action on right away, is it?
Yeah, I'll take action if that's
bingo.
This happens all the time. The biggest problem is to keep from laughing because, and sometimes you can go very positive to go negative. You might want a negative answer. Gee, Christian, all those other people you were talking, they're good people. You want to work, why aren't you working with them? They're good people. And then that forces you to bring out the negative on my competition without me doing it.
It's like a game of hide and seek. It is.
Psychological warfare.
It's a push ball.
Hide and seek. It's like a hide and seek game.
They will never see what you're doing if you practice and you do it well enough. They will not see what you're doing while you're doing it because it seems so fluid, so natural. Okay. And what you're doing is not manipulation. It is making someone comfortable enough to see the value that you bring to the table.
Yeah. Got it.
Gentlemen, what a great session. Thank you,
Claude.
So
thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Claude.
Always fun. Take care.
All right, guys. Have a good Thanksgiving, everyone.
Be safe.
Happy Thanksgiving. Yes.